get started on what I'd very like to talk about this evening, I thought you might be interested to know that some of those sayings that you say, and you don't know where they came from, and you don't know quite whether they make sense, well, there was a time when they made sense. What do I mean? Take, for instance, this musket. There are three main parts to this musket. There is, of course, starting at the bottom, this wooden piece that holds everything together is the stock. And there is the trigger and the hammer mechanism that is called the locking assembly, or the lock assembly. Of course, up top, there is a long steel barrel. So put in another manner, if I wish to describe the whole musket, it would be lock, stock, and barrel. If you were to walk through an 18th century army camp or street, you see a lot of these tricolors. But in an army camp, you would see a few darting about that had a plume coming out of them, a quill pen, which we wrote with a quill. And some people might think that these were officers, but actually more than often they were not officers, many times designated by a sash or a cockade wrapped around the top or attached inside. The folks with the plumes, more unusually than not, were people who were advertising that they could read and write. Because this is something that not most people could do sufficiently at a high level at that time. And reading and writing allowed them quite special privileges, because one of the most important elements of successful battlefield tactics is good information. And people who could read and write could receive incoming messages from headquarters and other units, dispatch other ones to advise them in their situation. So they were given quite often during camp treatment. And this was not always well taken by the common foot soldiers, who thought they were the ones who were getting shot and stabbed, and did not like the way they saw these people being treated. So in that sour note, it came to be said that anyone who had an attribute, not just reading and writing, anyone who had an attribute that would allow them special privilege or special attention was said to have another feather in their cap. You are familiar with, of course, Yankee Doodle. But the version that you know now is not the version you would have heard in Life and Drone on the Battlefields in the 18th century. It's very similar, you will recognize it, but it's not so peppy. It's more deliberate. It's more simple. I will attempt to. Patriots, or the Sons of Liberty, or the rabble, depending on who you're talking to, did have a nasty habit of almost always meeting in taverns and pubs. That's where they hung out, it's the truth. And for this reason, it bore them quite a bit of scorn from the Tories and the Loyalists. So, as things were heating up, leading to the crisis of the Tea Party, Patriots suggested that one method of getting back at England tea was a very popular drink then. Very popular. In the general population. And a lot of people who weren't really full supporters of the Patriot cause, but in this particular instance of tea were somewhat sympathetic to them, said that they would agree to a boycott of English tea if the Patriots would agree to a boycott of rum. And just for the record, there was no boycott of English tea during the tea party, so I'll leave the rest of that for you. Rally Mohawks, bring out your axes, and tell King George we'll pay no taxes. That was the pub cry of choice all over town after the Boston Tea Party. Places like the Green Dragon Tavern on Union Street, the Bunch of Grapes on King Street, the Tavern of Salvation Alley, pubs all over town. But just exactly what was this tea tax anyway? Well, monetarily, it was 3 pence per pound of tea leaves. And in more practical terms, what that means is that an average colonist would have to have consumed 1 gallon of tea every day for an entire year to wind up owing a little less than 1 pound in taxes at the end of the year. And we must note also that all this time, the English were paying taxes right alongside of us. So could this have actually caused the dumping of the tea? Or could it perhaps be a little bit more? The original tea duty was actually a part of the Townshend Acts of 1767. The Prime Minister at that time was Charles Townshend. And though this act bore his name, he was actually much better known for his rollicking and bombastic speeches in the House of Commons, which most always came in the evening session of Parliament after he had partaken in quite a fastidious dinner, which earned him the nickname Champagne Charlie. Now, the trouble with the tea really didn't start 6 years later in 1773. At that time, the East India Company, which was the capital of the British Tea Empire, and had once been second only to the Bank of England among Britain's financial institutions, was now on the verge of collapse, insolvency, bankruptcy, because of mismanagement. And Parliament is now going to rush in to bail them out with a series of legislative proposals. Traditionally, the East India Company had sold its tea at public auction, where it had been bid on by English traders, who in turn sold it to merchants from America and England for export to its destinations. But now, to bail them out, Parliament was going to allow the East India Company to not only handle the sales, but also the shipping as well, and this created a near monopoly. American traders, like John Hancock, were going to be stripped of a major portion of their income because it was estimated that Americans consumed about 6.5 million pounds of tea a year, and now all of the American traders were shut off. This new system was also going to benefit only a privileged few who were fortunate enough to be licensed by the East India Company to handle the sales and distribution within their respective colonies. Add to this that in Boston, this privileged few just happened to include two of the sons and one son-in-law of the less than popular Governor Hutchinson. And this time, the citizens of Boston were in no need whatsoever for prompting to Sam Adams to become completely enraged. They saw through the duplicity easily. and down the colonies, people very quickly saw that if this were to prove very lucrative for the East India Company, which by all rights it should, then what would stop other English companies looking at this and wanting the same deal? And it was quite possible that we could sit over here and watch industry by industry, company by company, more monopolies be created. And sure enough, our trading vessels, our merchant fleet, our ability to compete would be shriveled up, and we would become completely dependent on Great Britain for our supplies, on their trade terms, and on their trade prices. Our merchant fleet would be put out of business. And what's more, with what we could do, with what we could export, people here would be pretty much reduced to being fur trappers, or fishermen, or lumber. That's about all we could do without sufficient trade of our own. This had just as much to do with the problem of the Boston Tea Party as any tax schedule. It was October of 1773 now. Four trading vessels. The Dartmouth, the Eleanor, William, and the Beaver were loaded with cargo, much of it tea, and they were sent to Boston. On November 2nd, the North End caucuses in Boston met, and they voted that the tea shipped by the East India Company shall not be allowed to land in the port of Boston. Shortly after this, Sam Adams wrote to a friend of his in London, and amongst his observations was he noted that one cannot foresee that port, but from all observations that I have been making, my next letter will not be upon a trifling subject. And on November 28th, the first of the four ships, the Dartmouth, pulled into Boston Harbor, carrying 114 chests of English tea. Before dawn the next morning, notices had been fixed on fences and trees all over. Friends, brethren, countrymen, that worst of plagues, the detested tea shipped for this port by the East India Company, is now arrived in Harbor. The hour of destruction, or manly opposition to the machinations of tyranny, now stare us in the face. The poster called upon every friend of his country to rush to Faneuil Hall upon the ringing of the bells at 9 in the morning. Crowd that Monday morning exceeded 6,000. And they all voted that the tea should be returned to the place from whence it came at all events, period. They also established a committee of 25, including Henry Bass and a silversmith named Paul Revere, to keep watch down at Griffin's Wharf 24 hours a day to ensure that none of the tea would be allowed to be unloaded. About this time, one of the owners of the dock, a Mr. Francis Roach, came to town to negotiate on behalf of his ship. He went to the next town meeting, and he took an allegiance there, swore that now he would honor the Patriots' ban on tea, and he would order his tea back to England without allowing it to be unloaded. Now, as I said, his ship had come to port with other items besides tea, of course, and these had all been allowed to be unloaded. So Mr. Roach went back down to the customs house, and he approached the customs commissioner about getting clearance to leave port. And he was informed by the commissioner that when his ship had docked at customs, the captain of the ship had given a declarations list of all items on board that were destined for the port of Boston. On that list was that tea. And he could not issue him a pass to leave the harbor until he had paid the duty tea duty could not be paid until the tea had been unloaded. And he had just come from a town meeting telling the Patriots and the town committees that he would not unload it, he would send it back to England, he gave his word on it. And now the Patriots posted down at the wharf, we're going to hold him to this. And as if all of this wasn't bad enough, the law gave Mr. Roch only 20 days to either pay that duty or be in violation of the Acts of Trade, at which point the Royal Navy would have full authority to confiscate or sink his ship. Mr. Roch had placed himself between a rock and a hard place. The 20-day grace period that he was given by the law was set to end December 17th. Well, soon enough, the next ship, the Eleanor, arrived in the harbor, and she was ordered to dock up alongside the dock so that the Patriots would not need to keep a second watch. The Beaver also approached, but I think it was smallpox or something had broken out on board while she was in the voyage, and so she was ordered to moor at an outlying island until she could be properly scrubbed and fumigated. Now, on December 11th, only 6 days left before the deadline, Sam Adams had Mr. Roch summoned before the town committee again and asked him point blank why he had not honored his pledge to send his tea back to England. Mr. Roch, very politely but very plainly, told him that due to circumstances beyond his control, it was legally impossible to honor the pledge he had made to them and yet leave the port illegally. Sam Adams was not impressed by this and strongly urged him to go back to the Commissioner of Customs and ask for another pass anyway. In fact, he even noted that he and several of the committee members would be more than happy to accompany him if he thought this might help the situation. So 4 days later, on December 15th, Mr. Roch, Mr. Adams, and several committee members went down to the Customs House. And he pleaded one more time for clearance to leave the harbor. Unfortunately, the Commissioner of Customs was quite unmoved by the whole scene, and he reiterated very strongly that a pass was going to be issued to leave the harbor when, and only when, the tea that was on that declarations list had been unloaded off that ship. Period. So, the next morning, Thursday, December 16th, virtually all of Boston's male population and several thousand onlookers from surrounding towns were either jammed into the old South Meeting House, or they were standing in the street braving a driving cold rain, trying to get close enough to a window so they could either see or hear something that was going on inside. Patriots had just learned that morning that the ship, the Beaver, had completed the fumigation and entered port, and now there were three ships at Griffith's Wharf. They also learned that the fourth ship, the Wilma, had been destroyed when she'd run aground off Cape Cod, so they were not concerned with her at all. Mr. Roch was summoned before the very anxious crowd, and this time he was told that he was going to make one last appeal to get a pass to leave the harbor, and that this time he was going to go directly to Governor Hutchinson to get it. The governor wasn't in town that day. He was at his country home 7 miles away. So to allow Mr. Roch the time he would need to travel out and then travel back, the meeting was adjourned until 3 p.m. For his part, Governor Hutchinson had seen this one coming a long ways away, and he was very ready for this little showdown. He had researched legal documents, and he had found a Massachusetts provincial law that strictly forbid him issuing a pass to any ship that had not cleared customs. So when Mr. Roach arrived at his mansion, he offered him only a small compromise. He would allow Admiral Montague of the Navy to tow the Dartmouth out to Castle William out of Boston Harbor, where the tea could be stored until more calm times prevailed. Mr. Roach strongly insisted that he could not do that, because if he did, the mob would turn its rage directly upon him. He flatly refused the governor's offer. At this point, the governor made Mr. Roach's visit quite short by announcing to him, "If I am to issue you such a pass, I would be a debtor, a violation of the acts of trade which I am sworn to uphold. Request denied. Good day, Mr. Roach. Someone will now see you to the door." And he left empty-handed. Of course, around here, these parts, that time of year, mid-December, starts to get dark early. Daylight starts to fade. Twilight starts to come. So when Mr. Roach arrived again at the Old South Meeting House, it had been beautifully lighted with the candles inside. It's a really stunning building. So he stood in front of the crowd and he announced to them that the governor had denied him a pass. And immediately, cries from the back started going up for a mob! But he yelled at town spokesman. They had two questions that they desired to ask Mr. Roach before they allowed events to take their own course. Everyone settled back down. One of the town councilors looked at Mr. Roach and said, "Do you still intend to now order your tea back to England?" Mr. Roach looked at his feet for a second. "Counselors, you know my situation. I cannot legally honor my pledge to you and leave the harbor at the same time. If I am to try to leave the harbor illegally, the Royal Navy has full authority to confiscate or to sink my ship, and I would lose the means by which I feed and clothe my family. No, I'm not currently ordering my ship back to England." A tremor rolled through the audience. Again, Counselor stood up, calming the audience. They leaned in. "Mr. Roach, do you now intend to order your tea unloaded at Griffin's Wharf?" Everyone's pulse began to race. Everyone slid to the front of their chair. Mr. Roach swallowed hard, looked over his accusers. "Gentlemen, I have done everything you have asked of me. I have exhausted every option made available to me. If I do not resolve this by tomorrow morning, the Royal Navy will end my livelihood, and I may be put on charges. I implore you to consider these things, because I regretfully must inform you that I have no options left. And yes, I want to order my tea unloaded at Griffin's Wharf." Immediately, Sam Adams shot out of his chair and yelled, "This meeting can do no more to save this country!" And that was a signal, because as soon as he said that, a yell came from up in the gallery. And after they were done, 40 or 50 men who had been lurking outside the doors burst on in and started racing through the crowd. They were dressed up as Indians, and they started going to this crazy war whoop. And when they did that, at that point, every man in that building exploded. fist in the air and screamed at the top of his lungs. Families three blocks away, in their houses, could clearly hear the eruption. Boston Harbor, a teapot tonight! The meeting broke up when John Hancock stood, waved his arms, and shouted above the chaos, "Let every man now do what is right in his own eyes!" And then the crowd leaped up, the mob stormed the doors, headed for the street, and poured down to the walk, and they were screaming every step of the way. Even went out to the governor's mansion that he was never going to get a pass. You see, the governor and Sam Adams had grown to know each other quite well over several years, and they had grown to be able to anticipate each other's moves quite nicely. Now, the depth of how well this event was staged is actually the beauty of it. And let me enlighten you. Those Mohawks that burst into the Old South Meeting House, well, while Mr. Roch had been going to and from the governor's mansion, they spent their afternoon in the parlor of Mr. Benjamin Eddy's, putting on their war paint and gathering their costumes and guiding the door inside. Mr. Eddy's had a younger son named Peter, and Peter was banished to a side room where he was given the dubious task of providing copious amounts of rum punch for the Mohawks. So by the time it came to there to burst through that door, they were quite ready to do so. Further yet, consider a man named James Brewer. He made shipping gear for a living. And he had a house right down by the docks. And because of its location, his house had been picked out ahead of time as a strategic point. A lot of the men who were going to be taking part in the dumping of this tea had no disguise of any sort. So his wife had a great big bowl full of burnt black cork ashes. And the men were told to go to his house. And they went in, and she took a rag, and she smudged their faces, and kicked them on out, booted them on down the pier, and let the next group of guys. And as far as the men themselves, they were already pre-divided into three ranks, each of about 50, and with a commander. And the overall leader of this entire escape was a Captain Lindahl Pitts. And I must tell you about Georgie Hughes. Georgie Hughes was so short that he actually went so far as to nail another heel to his shoe to persuade the army to take him during the French and Indian War. But for this evening, Georgie was going to be needed for a much different reason. So he worked on the docks. Up and down the wharfs, he was very well known for the power of his whistle. This is important because talking was going to be very, very limited, very strongly discouraged. And his strong whistle earned him the position of head boatswain for Captain Pitts. And so his job was to whistle the orders to the different companies of men as they ran aboard each ship. He was very happy to do this. Well, the rain that had been coming down earlier in the day had stopped. But the clouds had lifted and broken, and a beautiful moon was out, shone over the wharf beautifully. The visibility was not a problem. And see, the low tide had just ended. The water was starting to come back in. That's about the time the boarding parties landed on the decks of the three ships. Now, when Captain Pitts had led his men aboard the ship they were going to take care of. He sent what has to honestly be called a very polite message to the ship's first mate, because the captains had all gone ashore and the first mate's not in charge. Sent a message to the first mate asking him if he may have as many lanterns and candles as possible and the keys to the ship, because he did not want his men to damage anything unnecessarily, because all they wanted was the tea. And he was very relieved to find that the first mate had responded quite gentlemanly in return, had surrendered the keys immediately, and had even sent his own personal cabin boy to go round up as many candles and lanterns as he could find. Back out on the docks, the sailors from these ships were actually now helping the Mohawks attach the block and tackle to the chests of tea and hoist them up out of the hold. And at first thought, that might seem rather curious, until you stop and remember that these men had been stuck in Boston for almost 3 weeks, and it was all on account of that tea. They were just sailors. They didn't have anything in investments or laws or anything. Quite honestly, they wanted to get on with it. They wanted to go home. They were poor. And they had come to hate that tea. And not only that, they knew full well more than anybody that come tomorrow morning, they were going to have to square off against the Royal Navy, and that they were going to lose, and that once their ship had been confiscated, they were going to wind up who knows where and for who knows how long. So they were a pretty glum group. And then, at the last minute, here comes this group of really enthusiastic town folk, and they keep screaming, they've got to have that tea. So they decided that this was not the time to think about what the captain might think of the whole thing, and they decided to give these guys a hand. And they did. Again, I want to reiterate, this whole thing was so carefully planned, and so staged, and so quiet, that when the first blows from the hatchets actually hit the first chests of tea, people far, far back off the harbor in the Boston proper could hear the hatchet blows. It was absolutely under control. Now, as you might guess, about this time, this whole thing is starting to draw a crowd. People quite anxious to witness this. Among the bystanders was none other than the Royal Navy, because they were more just a couple hundred yards off the side of the harbor. Of course, with the moonlight, they were able to see everything. So was Admiral Montague. He was staying at the house of a loyalist that was right down at the foot of the docks, and he was looking out a window and witnessing the whole thing. Now, for their part, the Patriots were axing and shoveling and dumping tea at an absolutely maniacal rate, because quite honestly, they expected retaliation at any moment. And they simply wanted to get as much of the tea dumped as soon as they could before they got attacked. But what they didn't know was that Admiral Montague had no orders to stop them. He was of quite a mind to do so anyway, trust me. But he summed the situation up, and he saw that to take care of the situation, the Navy was going to have to shoot in towards the docks. And so many innocent and curious people had gathered at this point, he was concerned about killing too many non-effective people. So he very begrudgingly elected to do nothing. Once they got started, it only took them about 3 hours. And it was about 9 o'clock in the evening when the last of, I think it was 342 chests of tea had been hatcheted and dumped in Boston Harbor. The men were ordered to take their shoes off and shake them overboard, get all the tea out. They were ordered to brush each other off, get all signs of tea off so that no traces could be taken to individuals' homes or to pubs where they were likely to gather quickly. Also, after all this had been effected, the decks were ordered, swept, crystal clean. Everything was put back in place, and the first mates were allowed to come up to top deck so that they could testify that nothing had been destroyed except the tea, and that the ships were left in fine shape. after this was done, the captain arranged his men back on the wharf, put them in the ranks, and he marched them back into town, military style, with their axes and tomahawks and hatchets right on their right shoulder. Well, as they passed the house where Admiral Montague had been watching this whole thing, he couldn't stand it anymore. He threw open the window, and he yelled down at me, "Well, well, you had a fine evening for this little Indian caper, haven't you? But mind you, you're going to pay the fiddler yet." Captain Pitts looked right back up at him. Says, "Oh, never mind that, Squire, never mind. Just come on down here, if you please, and I'll settle the bill with you in 2 minutes." The Abbot slammed them shut, and then raised their axes and cheered and kept right on watching. Even though this event was really over, it continued to be a remarkable thing. The next day, anonymous patriots went so far as to send a new lock to one of the ship's captains to replace one that they had, unfortunately, they said, broken the night before. Even the Tories admitted in public that the whole evening had gone about as politely as a crime could have gone. And so then, the victorious patriots did gather in their towns, and they did toast themselves heartily, rally Mohawks, bring out your axes, and tell King George, we'll pay no taxes. This ends my account of Boston Tea Party. Listen, my children, and you shall hear the midnight ride of Paul Revere. On the 18th of April in 75, and barely a man is now alive who remembers that famous day and year. A hurry of hoofs in a village street, a shape in the moonlight, bulk and dark, and beneath, from the pebbles, in passing, a spark. Struck out by a steed, flying fearless and fleet. That was all, and yet, through the gloom and the light, the fate of a nation was riding that night. And the spark struck out by that steed in his flight kindled the land into flame with its heat. He has left the village and mounted the steep. And beneath him, tranquil, broad, deep, is the mystic meeting the ocean tides. Under the altars that skirt its edge, now soft on the sand, now hard on the ledge, is the herd, the tramp of his steed as he rides. It was 12 by the village clock when he crossed the bridge into Medford town. He heard the crowing of the cock and the barking of the farmer's dog, and felt the damp, the river's fog that rises after the sun goes down. It was 1 by the village clock when he galloped into Lexington. He saw the gilded weathercock swim in the moonlight as he passed. And the meeting house windows, blank and bare, gaze at him in a spectral stare, as if they already stood aghast at the bloody work they would look upon. You know the rest in the books you have read, how the British regulars fired and fled. How the farmers gave them ball for ball from behind each fence and farmyard wall, chasing the redcoats down the lane and crossing the fields to emerge again under the trees at the turn of the road, only pausing to fire and load. And so through the night rode Paul Revere, and so through the night let his cry alone to every Middlesex village and farm, a cry of defiance and not of fear. Lord's land. In the hour of darkness and peril, the people will awaken and listen to hear the hurrying hoofbeats of that steed and the midnight message.